We have with us India's Chief of Defence Staff, General Bipin Rawat, today to discuss the preparations that must be made for a tech-driven future.
General Rawat, first over to you on this message that you want to convey, which is of great significance.
You know, as I walked into this conclave, I was wondering whether we men and women in uniform, which form part of the armed forces, are in the right place, because this is really an economic conclave. And the militaries around the world are normally perceived as being guzzlers of funds. So to say that we are a non-productive organization which only eat into the funds of the nation. And therefore, we are seen as a burden on the state exchequer. But I think I am here to change that myth. Because no nation can ever be financially stable unless the external and internal security environment is stable. Therefore, to bring about economic stability, it is very important that you have a strong military and armed forces. And particularly for a nation like India, you need strong armed forces, because we've got belligerent neighbors on our northern and western borders. Especially with the COVID-19 situation that we are going through, you need sustainable economies, but yet you also need strong defense forces. Now, hiding behind the veil of confidentiality, militaries around the world have often failed to take advantage of the success made by the civilian industry in developing state-of-the-art technologies that can be put to dual use by the military. Therefore, present-day concepts of war fighting are being redefined. The major focus must therefore be on imbibing technology, and needless to say that future battles may no longer be won with big armies, but with armies that have succeeded in harnessing cutting-edge technology. I would say that it is time for the armed forces in India to transform, to reform, and to perform. And with that, I would say that if we do not imbibe technology in the armed forces, we may not succeed in our missions in future. Therefore, the time has come to, rather than banking on human resources, we start banking more on technology by empowering the soldier, sailor, and airman who has to deliver in combat.
We're also talking about, of course, the strategic dimension to Atmanirbharta. So, General Rawat, how close are we to becoming a force which is self-reliant and perhaps indigenized to the point where our dependency on expensive imports will be over?
We did have a good defense industry. However, over the years, we relied exclusively on the capabilities of our DPSUs, our ordnance factories, and the sole inventor of research and development was the DRDO. But I think now times are changing. We have seen the manner in which the automobile industry revolutionized the way in which we are now moving around in swanky cars and other things that we have. Look at the way the IT industry revolutionized. Who brought in this industrialization? It all happened with the private sector. And I think now if we start looking at facilitating the private sector in bringing in good technology within, whether they collaborate with some foreign OEMs, but start developing everything that we need for our defense purposes in-house, I think that may be the way forward. And that is what we are trying to do, is to support the Indian industry in developing products for our military. That will help us in two ways. One is that we will be able to give a push to the Indian industry and let them invest in research and development. At the same time, we will also throw a challenge to our own research and development organization, the DRDO, and the DPSUs and ordnance factories, because they will now have competition that they will have to face. And when there is competition, you find that the products improve. And I think with that, we may be able to achieve our mission of Atmanirbhar Bharat in defense manufacturing.
So you'd said that change obviously is resisted. Where is this resistance coming from?
Well, resistance comes from the fact that, in our armed forces, you have an army which is the largest, then you have the Air Force and you have the Navy. Now, when you see such a large army, obviously the other two services have a feeling that we will get usurped by the army and that the army will take over everything and will finally control everything that we have. I think that is a myth which should be dispelled, because as I said, each service has its own potential and capability which we have to identify. What the Air Force can do in battle, the Army or the Navy cannot do. What the Navy can do on the high seas, the Army and the Air Force cannot do. So each one will have its own charter. They will have their own roles and responsibilities based on their strengths. And I think we need to capitalize on the strengths of each service to make sure that we integrate, yet we ensure the autonomy of each service, single service, remains. So I think that is something which we have, being resisted all these years, but I think that has now been overcome and the services are now moving together. They have understood that change is for good and that it will happen and it must happen.
The Chinese are expanding, not just threatening our border regions, but also, of course, in the South China Sea. They're moving into the Indian Ocean region aggressively. How does India counter that? We've talked about the land dimension, but how do you defend against an enemy that is also coming in through the sea?
See, Indian Ocean is not India's ocean. This is an area where 70% of the world's trade moves, you know, through merchant ships and what have you. Large part of the oil reserves or all requirements of the countries in this area passes through this region. Therefore, if any nation has to confront India in the Indian Ocean region, I don't think India will stand isolated. India will automatically get support of nations which are also using the Indian Ocean for their trade and other issues that are there. So I don't think we need to get completely overwhelmed by what the Chinese are doing. Chinese are developing their naval power not just for the Indian Ocean region, they are aspiring to become a global power. So whatever they are trying to develop as far as their naval resources are concerned, it is for domination of the, you know, of the globe as a whole. You know, they want to reach out to nations. They have invested in Africa, they have invested in the Americas, they have invested in the Southeast Asia. So they've got to now protect all their investment. And for protecting their investment, they have to use the sea route. And therefore, they are developing their navies for that purpose. And I don't think we should get so concerned about it. Let us also not forget that the way the Indian Peninsula projects into the Indian Ocean region, I think it gives us a tremendous advantage because we are able to naturally dominate the Indian Ocean from our land borders along the coastline. At the same time, we are also blessed with island territories on our east and west coast. We've got the Andaman Nicobar Islands and the Lakshadweep Islands. If we can develop these islands into islands of resistance, I think we should be able to keep our adversary at bay by not just dominating from the oceans, but also developing and creating bases in these island territory of ours, whether we develop them for seaborne assets or we launch them for the foodborne assets, the military assets, in the air domain, in the, I would say armed forces as a whole. If you look at it from that perspective, I think we should be able to take care of our interests. Talking about South China Sea, again, we are looking at Indo-Pacific. Indo-Pacific is again being developed for free movement of trade in this area. It's being to ensure that the stocks are free of any intervention. So once again, you find that there are nations which are coming up together with India to ensure that there is free movement of trade and traffic that happens along the Asia-Pacific or the Indo-Pacific. So we do have this advantage because of the kind of trade that moves in this area. I don't think we will ever get isolated in the Indian Ocean region. It will not be our sole responsibility to defend everything that happens in the Indian Ocean region. There we will be developing some kind of coordinated approach with the other nations.
Well, one grouping that is coming together is the Quad. We've just had summit-level conversations. And I just wanted to ask you, do you ever see it sort of developing into a NATO kind of alliance directed at perhaps China? Or will it have a larger role, which is perhaps more economic, more trade-centric, more about defending, larger issues and defending greater ideas like democracy, etc.
The Quad should not be seen from that perspective. The Quad is a, you know, arrangement between nations which want to ensure free movement of trade through the India, through the Indo-Pacific region. So therefore, nations are coming together to ensure that no single nation is able to dominate this region along the seas. So I don't think there is a need to look at it from the military perspective or against a particular nation. It is just that a group of nations want to ensure that there is free movement of trade, because as I said, large part of the trade of any nation moves through this area. And we all want security of our trade, we want security of these locks. So this arrangement is actually coming from that perspective. I don't think it has got anything to do with the military angle yet to be given to this arrangement that is there. And Quad is therefore more of a of an alliance only for, I wouldn't say alliance, it's a cooperative mechanism to ensure free passage of trade and you know, these, so that these locks are not interfered with by any particular nation or a group of nations.
Thank you very much, General Rawat, for speaking to us and enlightening us on the challenges and, of course, the future of conflict, especially driven by technology. Thank you very much. Introduction. We have with us, of course, the Army Chief. He needs no introduction. Army Chief, I know before we get into our interaction, you want to say a few words on the emerging security situation around the world, and also, of course, in our neighborhood. I'd invite you to begin with your introductory comments.
I would just like to touch on a few issues. When we think of national security, we should see it in a very wholesome manner, and it includes the external threats and challenges, as well as the internal challenges that we have. The external threats, of course, we are taking care of in maintaining the sovereignty and territorial integrity of the country and making sure that nobody can impose his will on us. But then security also has many other dimensions. It includes energy security, food security, social security, and in this era of the COVID pandemic, even health security. If you don't have a healthy population, you cannot say that your nation is secure. And therefore, there is no doubt that we need to have a very safe and secure environment if we want to prosper as a nation. And it is a responsibility of the state, of the government of the day, to make that security possible. And of that, I think there is no doubt in anybody's mind. But sometimes what comes up for debate is how much should we spend on this security? The guns versus butter debate. And many feel that our expenditure on security is a waste of the taxpayers' money and a sunk cost. But that's one view. I would like to give a different view, that whatever we spend on security is actually an investment, and an investment on which you get good returns, both tangible and intangible. You just have to see that whenever there is tension, what happens to the share market. Even the other day, when the surge in the COVID cases took place, when even other countries put in fresh measures, a slew of measures and lockdowns, it immediately had an impact on the share market, stock market. So security has these wider dimensions. And therefore, I feel that whatever you spend on security is actually an investment.
It's difficult, isn't it, for you to be doing this job in such polarized times? You're not just dealing with the propaganda that comes from across the borders, both Pakistan and China, but also a large number of individuals here who constantly question the integrity of your own statements vis-a-vis the actual situation on the LAC. How do you rationalize when these statements come your way, when you read about them in the papers or watch them on channels?
No, I don't think that anybody is making any statement which goes really counter to what we feel or what we say. Everyone has a different perception and a different take. And then I think everyone is entitled to his own opinion.
A large number of opposition leaders will say that, look, we've conceded territory, which is sort of, you know, indirectly implying that the army didn't do its job, didn't stand its ground. How do you react to that?
No, we are, you know, we are quietly confident of our own capabilities. We know what we have done, what we have achieved. And of course, credit for that goes entirely to the officers and men who have withstood such harsh winters in very inhospitable terrain and climate, minus 35, minus 37, with a wind chill factor. So they have done their job, and we should see the positives, the glass half full or glass half empty. I would rather see it as 3/4 full and not, and ignore that other part.
So you're basically calling upon some of these doubters to say, look at things with a glass 3/4 full. Yeah. That's what you're
saying.
That's
right.
How does it feel when they don't do this? And when you know that you are absolutely honest, not just with yourself, but with this nation? It must, at some, I'm sure it has an effect on your morale, perhaps at some level, or even your expectations. You might think
No, not at all. In the army, you learn to be thick-skinned.
That's wonderful. That's really wonderful, because that's the spirit, viewers. That's the spirit which stands India in good stead. Remember this. The army takes it. The forces take it on their chest. They don't turn their back. So to all of those individuals who question constantly on a daily basis the claims of our army and the establishment that gets briefed by the army, these are the words that they need to focus on. Let me just quickly ask you, so the rising footprints of China, and this is what you said last month, in India's neighborhood and its attempts to unilaterally alter the status quo along our disputed borders have created an environment of confrontation and mutual, I suppose you're saying, interest. You've also spoken about Chinese belligerence in the Indo-Pacific and its attempt to create regional dependencies through the Belt and Road Initiative. Can you elaborate on this? Because it did lead to a lot of chatter.
Well, as suppose all of us have been following the news, and only 2 days ago, they had sent more than 200 fishing vessels into the territorial waters of the Philippines. So this just goes to reinforce what I had said, that they are trying to force their way, especially unilaterally force their way and change the status quo with little regard for the interests of the other neighboring countries, most of whom are very, very much smaller than them, and I would say in a way trying to bulldoze their way. And I guess that is would not be acceptable to any self-respecting country. And all these countries are now realizing that they need to also take a stand and safeguard their interests.
Well, we've come together, at least certain countries that can stand up to China in this Quad initiative. We've just had a summit meeting. Would you see Quad as potentially a military alliance somewhere in the future?
The Quad is actually supposed to be a quadrilateral security dialogue. So by the, we keep calling it the Quad, but the actual aim of that was a security dialogue. And this will, of course, have a security part of it. But in this, every country will still be looking at its own interests. So it won't be an alliance in that sense. It won't be a military alliance. But there will be definitely military cooperation, both bilateral between the countries of the Quad and as a quadrilateral also. But it won't be a military alliance as in that sense.
We've been having a lot of conversations about modernizing the army in the context of the external security threats we're facing. Do you see a great disparity right now in infrastructure along the borders, all contested borders and all fractious borders? And what really are the steps that are being taken to restore balance if you do see an imbalance?
Infrastructure development actually is a continuous process. It would, you know, before Galwan, everybody used to keep asking that post-Doklam, what has changed? It is not as if post-Doklam we suddenly started making roads. Similarly, it is not as if post-Galwan we have suddenly started infrastructure development. Infrastructure development, improving of the connectivity in border areas, improving the habitat in border areas, this is a continuous and ongoing process. So we were never lagging behind in any manner.
General Narvane, it's been very pleasurable speaking with you. You've spoken like a true soldier and the defendant of the national interest along with all your forces. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. And thank you, everyone.